It's Kendrick with Technology Interpreters, and I want to welcome you to the first part of a series on endpoint detection and response. I would even go as far as to say a comprehensive class. And so today we're going to be showing you exactly what the interface looks like, and we're going to go ahead and start here. So this is SentinelOne. Now, SentinelOne is one of the top endpoint detection and response products in the world. This is what big companies use, not necessarily things that the names that you know. So if you don't know SentinelOne, CrowdStrike, Trend Micro, those type of things, you may want to become acquainted with them because these are some of the ones that the bigger corporations use. And so let's start off. So the first thing we want to look at is, and I'm going to be going with my notes here, is let's talk about tenants. So in the world of cybersecurity and what's called an MSSP, a managed security service provider, which is what I work for, we have many customers. And so these interfaces are our MSSP console, which allows us to manage multiple customers. And the way that we go about changing let me explain the structure here. So to start off, it starts with global, which means that I don't have access to the global because if I were big enough, I could buy this directly from SentinelOne. But since I'm a small company, Technology Interpreters, I have to buy it through another company that's big enough to buy directly from SentinelOne, and they have access to the global. So I'm actually able to be a company that provides security to other companies while being in the console of a company that's selling to other companies like me, or the company I work for that sells security services to other companies. Like a pyramid, right? So anyway, the way it works is the global level, which is going to be the Ariat advisors. They're the company that I get this from. They have access to global level, and these things propagate down so they can put policies, scripts, all kind of configuration in, and it will apply to my console and all my customers. And the same thing, it would apply to any other customers that they have and all of their customers. Okay. And my customers are just the mentees in the program. So actually, this is not my primary job. I do teach on this console, but this is purely for me to have to show you what endpoint detection and response really is. So how does this work? I'll say you got the global level, they have access to it. And then this is the account, which is my account. And once again, they have other MSSPs like myself who have accounts in there, right? And then under the accounts, you have the sites, which is going to be, say for instance, if I had individual customers, what you see here, I got the other mentees here. I'll go to this level right here so you can kind of see. So I've got the other mentees listed right here, and these are their sites. You see, that's where they're doing their practice and stuff like that. But people who are in the cybersecurity mentorship program. All right, and so then we have that level, and we can go to technology interpreters, and then we have groups within the site. So once again, I can have a monitoring group where I put the stuff in here, and the policies assigned to this group don't necessarily do anything but alert if there's an detection. But I also can have it where SentinelOne will actually do something and take action. And if there is a detection, we'll go ahead, kill, quarantine, remediate, roll back. Okay, so now we're in the tenant. Let's talk about the dashboard, okay? So if you're on the left side menu here, we got a lot of stuff here, okay? So we're gonna go through each of these individual items, and we're gonna tell you a little bit about it. So on the dashboard, you got the solved and unsolved threats and mitigated threats, right? So when there's an incident, then you need to take action on it, right? And once you complete whatever action you did on the incident, you can mark it as solved, okay? But until then, it's listed as unsolved in the console. And I'm gonna go into details in other parts of this series. I'm gonna go into all the details about this. Infected endpoints and healthy endpoints. So once again, if your endpoint has some type of detection or there's an incident for a particular endpoint, it is listed as infected. Once it's mitigated, it is listed as healthy. You got detection engines. We'll go into those. Those are part of the policies, but there's static detection, which detects files that are on your machine. You got other type of like detection engines that detect scripts that maybe run that don't have anything to do with files and stuff like that. So lots of different detection engines. And this is the artificial intelligence behind it that actually goes through and does things to actually fix or remediate a detection. And then you got threats by type, which is over here. So threats by type, once again, you can have malware, you can have potentially one programs. There are like nine different, maybe more than nine different categories that SentinelOne divides these threats into. Okay. Also on the left hand menu, you got the little magnifying glass. This is called deep visibility. And so this is where it allows you to basically do like when you're doing, either you're doing incident response to follow up on something that's been detected, or maybe you're doing threat hunting. But deep visibility allows you to run queries. And you see, I don't have access to this in this console. I could probably pay to have this feature added. but it allows you to do some really cool stuff. The reason that they don't enable it is because you could, if you don't know what you're doing in deep visibility, and I can get this enabled, they already told me I could, and maybe it's something I'll go into once we get further into the series. But if there's something that's not necessarily, you do a bad query, you could essentially lock up their whole console and lock up the database. And so they only enable this feature for people who are, they certify that you've been trained and know what you're doing. The Ranger product. This is used to identify devices that connect to your network and identify those that don't have SentinelOne agents. So this is a great way. If I come in, I plug my computer into your network, I don't have SentinelOne installed. Well, guess what? This Ranger product will detect it. Let me know I got a rogue on my network, and then we can reach out for, as far as the IT department, the security department, whatever, to get that device protected. Sentinels right here. These are going to be devices in the console. You see, I got, this is my VM. I'm going to move. I got an older laptop. That's a gaming laptop. I'm moving here, and we're just going to put all kind of vulnerable software on it. I'm going to use it for stuff in the future videos and stuff like that to show you the process of remediating vulnerabilities and responding to incidents and stuff like that. So, but anyway, this is where you see your endpoints, but it's also where you can do your policies, which is what determines, like, we're going to go into all these and explain all these. And these are different type of engines that you can't, like, that detect malware. You got block lists. You can block things, of course, exclusions. This is like programs that you may need to run, that you want to, like, that we detect them and we don't want SentinelOne to act on them. Network control, this is where we can integrate with the firewall to take action based on the firewall. Device control, this allows us to block USB devices and also Bluetooth devices. Packages, this is where we go to actually download the SentinelOne software. There's my site key. I'm probably gonna have to regenerate after showing that. But either way, I can regenerate that site key. Once again, if you install it using the site key, then it will put you in my tenant and all that stuff, and I'll just basically just regenerate it just to stop that. Site info, of course, this is all my information, my account information. Probably should show that. Gonna have to cut that out the video. And group ranking. So anyway, that's all of that. So let's go next. That covers, that's incidents. This is where we have detection. So I'm gonna go up a level. And so we had a few devices, and they kind of, you saw we ran iCar and some of the desktop devices and stuff like that that we had detections on. But anyway, this is where we go, and we have basically threats and alerts. So threats, once again, those AI engines, that's where threats come from. Alerts are, we able to set up certain type of conditions, and if things meet certain alert conditions, and once again, this feature that I don't have currently enabled with my agreement with the company, but that something happens and then it will generate alert. But alert is not a threat, okay? Threat is really what you're going to be, like, mostly focused on. Alerts are kind of more like proactive detection to kind of, like, build in some additional things in addition to the automatic or the AI engines and stuff like that that detect threats. Let's see. In addition to that, I think that's good there. We're going to go right here. Identity. All right, so identity. By the way, it says on the threats, I did make a note here that for the alerts, you create what's called power expressions to kind of define things that will generate these alerts. So basically, you kind of define certain criteria using this kind of query language, and this, it will generate alerts. On this, I don't have this identity feature, but in this feature, you have what's called Ranger AD, which reviews Active Directory. If you don't know what Active Directory, when you log into a Windows on a corporate network of usually a major company, you have to authenticate, put your credentials in and stuff like that. And typically, they're a Microsoft shop, and they have Active Directory, which is where your credentials are housed and stuff like that. And basically, you have to log in. Well, this Ranger AD product looks for indicators of compromise or any type of exposure related to Active Directory. It has what's called AD Secure EP, which replaces real Active Directory access. So the thing is, if I get on your network, there are different kind of hacks, right, that attack Active Directory, right? And I can't think of the name of it, but you put it in the chat. Y'all know the name of it. But anyway, you can't attack Active Directory. And then what this does is, instead of you, like, being able to identify real computers and accounts, it basically replaces those with fake accounts and fake assets or computer names to kind of throw an adversary off, which basically increases the likelihood that they're going to get detected, okay? You also have what's called Ranger AD Protect, which detects Kerberos, which is basically, Kerberos is a lot of times this way, it's a way where you're, like, accessing file shares. And make sure I correct me on this, because Kerberos, really confusing. I've dug into Kerberos and stuff like that. But when you're basically doing file share, Kerberos is what does these exchanges that prevents you from having to do all this like logging in constantly when you're accessing file shares and stuff like that. And so it exchanges credentials in a way using Kerberos and Kerberos tickets. But there's this process called Kerberosing that allows you to be able to like hack Kerberos, okay? It's not easy, I tried it, okay? Not easy. But anyway, Ranger AD Protect actually detects those type of detections. You have what's called Threat Strike, which detects lateral movement, basically me moving from one machine to another to attack it. And I just realized I don't even have a webcam. I just talking away here and no webcam. And then also you have, what's this? What else we got? Deflect, which basically when an untrusted endpoint gets on the network, it raises an alert. So great way of detecting stuff that may be rogue. So it basically says raises the event when untrusted endpoints access forbidden network access. So I guess if it's something on your network that you know you can kind of designate this shouldn't have access to, and you got a computer that's trying to access it, then this feature will then kind of like act on that, okay? And that's going. And then also you got Threat Path, which basically is a great, pretty cool feature. I'm actually probably going to recommend this as a potential solution for one of my customers, for the main company I work for, because the thing is, it's able to analyze it, and it kind of like shows the path that you could take to move laterally before somebody, some adversary, actually exploits it. Okay, and so then that's all that, and then we get down to what's called the applications. Okay, applications, which is right here, and this is cool. I love applications because you get a bonus here. So the thing is, application actually gives us a mini vulnerability scan. So they're able to, since SentinelOne already has an agent on the machine. And so what it's doing is actually this risk section, it's actually starting to do very much what like Tenable and Qualys is doing, which is being able to read the software, compare that against the CVSS to determine if there are vulnerabilities. And I think it was CVSS common vulnerability scoring system, which is what the kind of like, it's the governing body that basically determines whether this vulnerability is critical, high, medium, low, and stuff like that. It's the scoring system for that. So anyway, they're able to access that, compare it with the software that they're already seeing on your machine, which they already have agent, and then they're able to give you a risk and basically giving you kind of like a scaled down vulnerability scan, which is good. And we're actually using these to remediate, working with the mentees, we're using these to remediate vulnerabilities on our machine and not having to buy Tenable. And I actually have customers who actually are trying to rely on this as an alternative to Tenable for vulnerability scans. We got inventory. This is basically telling me all the applications and their versions, the stuff that's installed on my machine. And then we have policies right here. And what you can do is you can do an extensive scan, which is basically, to me, it seems like it just increases the fidelity of the vulnerability scan. And this confirms it. Like, it's literally saying vulnerability scan. So your risk is a vulnerability scan that SentinelOne has included. Once again, when it matures, they're probably going to break it out into a new product and charge you extra for it, okay? So, man, a lot going on. Activity. This is where anything that happens in a console, this is your audit log. This is like anything that you want to know. If I log in, if I remote into somebody's machine, which you can do through SentinelOne, I'll be showing you that feature in upcoming videos. Log in, log out the whole night. I initiate a scan. I decommission, or basically there's a device that's been gone. It's never going to check in again. I decommission it, which flags it, so it doesn't show up in the interface. All these things show up right here in this activity log, okay? So this is my bread and butter when I'm trying to see what I was doing. Like, if I want to see if somebody's in here, I feel like somebody might have logged in and done something they want to. Well, it's going to be right here in this activity log. So love that. Let's see, what else we got? We got reports. Reports is straightforward. You can generate PDF reports, some different metrics and stuff like that. We'll dig into reporting. Automation is cool because, first of all, you got this remote ops task. I was even digging into the documentation. Don't necessarily know what the tasks are. Maybe it's because I don't have any remote ops created, but the company that owns this, they have a lot. I'm going to show this because these are their scripts. I don't want to expose that to everybody on YouTube, you know what I'm saying? But if you become one of their customers, you can see it, you know what I'm saying? So, but anyway, they got all these different scripts that they're running, PowerShell scripts, shell scripts, that you can run on large groups of machines to either fix things, remediate vulnerabilities, all kind of stuff. Really cool. Glad to have this feature and plan on using. And this is a setting, the remote settings is where basically you can include default credentials and stuff like that. And once again, I don't have permission. based on my access. And then we get into the settings section. Okay, and this is great because this is where I'm not going to click on a lot of these, but you can set up the notifications, so you can go here and add the groups, and you can notify on different aspects. And that's a lot of options in the notifications. Okay, so, and basically you can send the notifications either via syslog or email. Okay, syslog or email. Syslog is when you send it to like a server that's aggregating logging information from lots of other devices. Like it could be Splunk, it could be Elastic, it could be some others. And it's aggregating that information, and then it's presenting that information in some way, shape, or form that allows you to be able to like kind of like sift through the information to find something specific. So syslog and email alerts, you put your recipients in here. Then of course you got, well, I'm already know notification, you got users. I'm not going to click there because this is where I have the user set up who are access to the console integration. We can do SMTP, syslog, and single sign-on, which is like logging in through an identity and access provider like Okta or something like that. So we can configure that. Oh, it looks like that's just the syslog information. I'll click off of that. Policy override. This is helpful. Sometimes we have SentinelOne, like not, we can't put in an exclusion for a process that's like, we want SentinelOne not to act on something. And so what we would do is we put in an exclusion, but if the exclusion doesn't work, then we sometimes have to do a policy override, which makes it literally, it's just kind of like code that really gets very detailed and tells the detection engines not to touch this. So it's like a step beyond an exclusion. Exclusion is just saying a process, or ignore this hash, or ignore this executable, or ignore this file type, or something like that. A policy override is literally telling the engine, the AI engine, what to not touch, what to not do. Stand down on this particular feature or this particular whatever search or whatever parameter we define. Okay. All right, man, that's a lot. Okay. All right. So then we got accounts. I'm not going to click on accounts. This basically shows the accounts. We got sites. Okay. So we basically, these are all the sites that are in SentinelOne, and these are the sites right here. Okay. So remember global, this is my account. And then these are the sites for the people that are in the mentor program. And then also the one I'm just using for testing and one I use to manage my devices too. Let's see what else we got. Locations. Locations, we can go into locations. So it's pretty cool because it allows us to define certain parameters. So based on general, like we can put location name, description, IP address, DNS server, DNS resolution, network interface, SentinelOne connection, connected or not, registry key, and then also, let's see, what was one? Network interface, wired or wireless. So we can basically use these parameters to group like different devices into a location to act on them in a certain way. And that's it. So that's a lot. That's a lot, okay, that I covered in a short period of time. 17 minutes of straight talking. But this is a good interview. This is just the overview. We haven't even dug into any of the features, but if this is helpful and you want to learn endpoint detection and response, subscribe to my channel. I'm about to upload this video. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I said that already, and I'll see you on the next video.